future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
She's passionate about telling stories of amazing women who are rocking the world and empowering women to live, love, and thrive. Here's your host, Catherine Gray.
Thank you, and welcome to Live, Love, Thrive, Women's Empowerment Hour, brought to you by 360 Karma. You know, this week we have two really awesome people from the Hollywood entertainment industry. Later in the show, we're going to have accomplished actor and rising star, Jaylen Moore. He has performed with such greats as Reese Witherspoon and Sofia Vergara. He has a new series coming out that's very exciting that we're going to talk about. And he is just really a big supporter of women's empowerment. We love Jaylen, so we'll see him later in the show. But first, we have a real pioneer in the fashion industry. Please welcome celebrity stylist Joanne Lavin. Hi, Joanne.
Hi, Catherine.
Hey, good to have you here.
I'm so happy to be here. I love your show.
Oh, girl, you speak like... You know, celebrity stylist.
Yes, right.
Yes.
I'm really a get-down kind of girl.
Yeah, I mean, like, I thought, what do I wear when I'm on a celebrity stylist? Oh, I don't have a chance in heck.
Wait, do you know that everybody does that?
Really?
Every time I go out, somebody says, I really want to think about what I'm wearing. Like, I don't really care. It's okay.
I love that. I don't care.
Well, I want to redress everybody.
No, I was going to say, in your head, you must be going, they should do this,
yes,
they
right.
should do that.
Change the shoes or whatever. It's innate in my personality.
Right. Right. And it is a gift.
Yes.
You know, and we're going to talk about that. You have a fascinating story.
Long.
Yeah. And it's so funny, you know, I always say, you know, you can know people in your circle or, you know, in your life and friends of friends and whatnot, like we've been, and you never know their backstory.
Yes.
And that's what I love about the show is we get to delve into the backstory. And in your case, it's a very cool story.
Well, thank you.
So your parents, both of who were very creative like you.
Yes.
Your mom was a professional dancer.
Yes.
Your dad was a window trimmer.
Yes.
And they ended up buying a fashion boutique.
Yes. Out of the clear blue.
Yeah. And this was in New York.
No, Chicago.
Hello. And in Chicago. And what was the name of it?
The Pompeian Shop.
The Pompeian
yes.
Shop. Okay. And that's kind of where you got your beginnings of being introduced to the fashion industry.
I say I was born into it because my mother was pregnant with me.
Wow.
So that's all I knew.
When they bought the shop.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
So I came out of the womb.
Like, into the shop.
As a stylist.
You really yeah. did.
I was short, but good.
Yeah. But it actually is a really interesting path, how
yes.
you got to be a stylist, a celebrity stylist, no doubt less.
This is true.
Working in the store there, of course, you learned all the aspects of sales and,
yes.
and buying and whatnot.
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
It was everything.
Yeah.
I mean, basically starting from scratch and
yeah.
even going to Europe on buying trips, that was brand new
yeah.
to the world.
And you said that besides being creative, your mom was a good businesswoman?
She was good and tough.
Yeah.
There was nothing like, it wasn't sweet. It wasn't like, oh my God, you're doing a great job. It was,
yeah.
she was sort of like.
Yeah. But then we talked about that kind of tends to make us who we are.
Exactly.
So I recently was at some talk and they were talking about, you know, when you look back and you say, oh, my parents were tough on me or, you know, it was really hard. You wouldn't be who you are today if that hadn't occurred. So,
yes.
you know, something good came out of it.
Like,
you know.
No, everything amazing came out of it.
Probably a really good work ethic.
It made me tough.
Yeah.
It really did because I had to learn things on my own. And it wasn't like they told me I did the best job. And so I was more like, I'm going to do it anyhow and
yeah.
learn how to be myself.
Yeah, it made you
great.
A little rebel, didn't it?
I am a rebel without a cause. Or with a cause.
Right.
I'm never quite sure. It depends
with
who
and
I'm
without,
talking
it depends on the day.
Or who I'm with.
I like that. But a rebel nonetheless.
Yes.
So eventually, after working in the business, and by the way, your family was trailblazers, pioneers.
Yes.
In that they were the first, among the first, to go over to Europe.
Yes.
And start buying European goods and bringing them back.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. This was a whole group of boutiques all over the country and major stores. Everybody would think, oh, maybe we should go to Europe and check it out. And I actually didn't tell you one story that was really funny. My mother and I went for the first time, and everybody did. We didn't know what we were doing. So the buying office gave us this hotel to stay at. And so now we're going into this hotel, and it's, like, so weird. Like, there's no, like, bathroom in the room, and, like, it's, like, all these, like, girls are walking around, and we realized we were in, like, a brothel.
Oh, no.
Like,
are you kidding?
Yes, we had to get out. It was so weird.
Gosh.
We're like, what?
That's where they put you up?
Yes, it was so weird. Like, my mother, who was
maybe
very
sophisticated. Maybe they thought, oh, sure, you're here buying, wink, wink.
Well, we'd have a bathroom outside in the hallway sharing. It was like, okay, this is wrong. Something's wrong about this.
So that's how it started.
This is how it started. And there were many years of the most amazing fashion experience, even more than today. I mean, today it's really celebrity-based, but then it was down and dirty. It was Harper's Bazaar. It was all these great editors, and everybody was fighting to get in to see all these great shows. It was pretty amazing.
Quite something,
yes.
Huh? And that was really the beginnings of the import of these designer clothes into the U.S.
Not only that, everybody had to figure out how to import it because it was always three times the amount of money.
Right.
And what was worth what, and nobody spoke English, and you had people that were interpreting. And then you saw amazing shows with amazing music from Comme des Garçons and all these great designers. It was something. Yeah. And then what would happen is when you go to Europe like that, you come home a different person.
Yeah.
I mean, Europe makes you different.
I think anytime you travel anywhere, like, you know, I've spoken to friends that have moved, that have lived in also in third world countries as well as Europe. And, you know, they all say it impacted their life. It changed their view of the world. You do come back a different person.
Totally. I almost came back speaking French, but I mean, you know, you'd go there one way and then I'd come back and I'd be wearing scarves, I'd be changing outfits. It was like, it's a whole nother thing. It really is. It's a great experience.
Yeah, dressing French, kissing French, whatever.
Well, that would be nice too. Whatever works.
Whatever works. So, but one of the times you went, you didn't come back. You end up living in Paris.
Actually, I finally left my parents' store.
Okay.
They were flipped out. They couldn't believe I actually did that. And I went to Paris and lived for a year.
Wow.
I wanted to just find my way. And I really didn't tell the buying office I was there. I thought, like, I'm going to discover life, which was exactly what I did.
Yeah. Oh, I bet that was fabulous.
Well, I call it my survival trip.
Yeah.
Because when you live in Paris, you don't, like, it's not like you're in a hotel.
Yeah.
Like, you want to find a laundromat because you have nothing. You have to walk 3,000 blocks.
Yeah.
Or carry groceries or it, and I brought my little Yorkie.
And you didn't speak French?
Never.
Oh, my
gosh. I've tried 1,000 times.
Yeah.
But I had a Yorkie that I snuck into the plane.
Oh, my gosh.
So, but, and I had her in this bag that said Sonia Raquel, and scarves around my neck, which I've always worn. And, like, everybody was nice to me.
Yeah.
And they never thought I was American. It was really an amazing experience.
Oh, that's cool.
Seriously.
And so you said that was life-changing. Like, that kind of put you on a new trajectory, right?
Well, it did, because, you see, I thought I was really independent until I moved away.
Yes.
And then I realized I knew nothing about the world.
Right, right. Right.
So,
And so what did you do there? You worked for some design houses?
No, what I did is I became a personal shopper.
And for Americans.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So when Americans would come over, if my parents would send me clients, I would take them shopping to great areas for clothes or down and dirty for inexpensive things and perfume. It was, they loved it. It was, if I decided to stay, I was going to, like, ship over this great, like, American limo and have a huge business, but it was time for me to come back. So.
Right. And that's when you moved to L.A.?
Well, I moved to Orange County. I was hired
right.
to be a buyer by a family that I knew for a chain of stores.
Oh.
So I lived in Orange County, and I always make a joke, and this is really sort of funny. I moved to to LA because I was in one of the stores in Fashion Island that I was working. Mm-hmm. And I looked down and I was wearing rhinestone gym shoes and I thought I had to get out of there.
Was the indication.
That was like, oh my God.
Oh my. Now there's some Orange County listeners still wearing those shoes.
Well,
so.
Actually, it's really hip probably now to do that. But I thought,
oh, good save.
I'm good at saving.
But then after Orange County, you made your way to L.A.
Yes.
And still not as a stylist, because that's another whole great story.
No.
But you came to L.A. and what were
and
you
then
doing
I got
here?
Jobs that I used to not necessarily be rude to people that would come to my store, but I became a wholesale representative for a leather company. Like, I was doing everything. When people would call me at my parents' store, I'd say, oh, call me back tomorrow.
Yeah.
Or maybe I'll see you next week.
Yeah.
Well, I was that person.
Yeah.
So that was another great lesson on how to be a lot more polite and understanding.
Right. So you were working with wholesalers and retail stores.
And then I got...
And stylists, right?
Well, I got into a situation where I worked for... a company that was product placement.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started bringing designers in from New York to do the credits on TV, like for Access Hollywood, and they would pay for that. Right.
So like when it says like wardrobe
by,
you would get product placements on TV shows.
Yes, and then I would go down and meet them at the stores, and I'd end up picking out everything.
So, for the stylist.
Yes. Yeah, so I thought, like, this is, something is wrong about this. I need to be doing this.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
And then I made friends with somebody that I was working with that had hired my companies, and she was moving to L.A., and she was starting a talk show as an exec producer. And she said, oh, I want you to come in for an interview. And it was Vicki Lawrence.
Oh, yeah. I remember that. Yeah.
She had
Love
this
her.
Daytime talk show, and I got hired. And that was the beginning of knowing nothing.
Yeah, that's the part of the story I love. You like, you didn't know what you were doing, but you thought, I'm just going to wing this.
Yes, I pulled my friend out of Gucci. I'll never forget. It was like you see in the movies. I got in my car, I went to Gucci, and at that time they were wearing different, the same outfit. It wasn't like they could wear just anything. Yeah. And I said to my dear friend, Dina Shoshone, like, you're out of here.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to come and work with me. You know, you'll meet Vicki. And that's how I started.
Right. So you pulled her out of Gucci to help you.
Yes. She was going to be the assistant, and I was going to be the stylist. And then we got hired. And then all of a sudden, we were at NBC sharing a room with The Tonight Show, knowing nothing. So now I'm sitting across from two stylists that are doing the show, and Dina and I are like looking at each other, and like we couldn't wait till they left the room so we could look in their set bags, because we didn't even know what a tape was. Seriously, we were like, what do we get? What
and you
do
didn't
we
want
do?
Them to know that you didn't
totally.
Know.
Totally. We were like, you know, every time they went to the bathroom, we'd look in. That's really how it happened.
That's how it happened.
That isn't, like,
And then I'm sure it just became second nature.
Oh, it was sort of. So amazing. My career from then on and my friends have been amazing. It's just been a great experience of different shows.
But, you know, actually, there's no better way to learn than to actually do it, you know.
And, totally.
And so learning on the job is the best way, and fumbling through, making mistakes. And, I mean, what better way to learn it? You know?
I say fake
Any
it
business.
Till you make it.
Any business.
Totally. I
yeah,
mean,
did you make that up, fake it till you make
no,
it?
No, I think you did.
Kidding.
You know,
okay, I'll take the credit.
You know, it's interesting because I've taken shows that I've known nothing about.
Yeah.
And, you know, you just have to do it. I think if you think too much, you do nothing. You, have to, you can't overthink.
So let's talk about some of the shows that you have done. I mean, you've done so many. I know American Idol.
I did the first season, was the best for
was
me.
Was that fun?
Oh, my God. Yeah. When I sat in Nigel's office, Lithgow, and he said, you're going to be on the biggest show in America, I thought, okay, and it was.
It really,
was
yeah.
The moment that it started, it was like
it was.
Amazing.
Yeah, that's very cool.
Yes. It, you
know, was it fun meeting the contestants?
It was, well, Kelly Clarkson and everybody, and at that time it was different. They didn't let you dress anybody from your own clothes. You had to pick out their clothes until the last 10.
You wait a minute. You mean they brought their own clothes and you had to pick from those?
Yes, but if you you remember or you look back, they looked one way, but then after all of that, they were
Transformation.
The transformation was amazing because
then you were picking the ones you wanted.
Exactly. And then there was makeup.
It was obvious.
And then there was hair. And then you saw this amazing transformation.
Yeah, it was always fascinating.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
how fun. And then some of the other shows, I know right now you're working on Crime Watch Daily with
Chris Hansen.
Chris Hansen, yeah.
Yes.
But you've worked on the Dr. Drew show and... Yes. I know you've worked with Susie Orman, who I love.
I know.
She's
amazing.
She's all about women's empowerment.
Oh, my God.
Empowering women financially. We love that.
Yes.
Yeah. And, you've worked really with a lot of amazing people. Both Justins, Justin Timberlake,
yes.
Justin Bieber.
Yes.
Just to name a few, Mark Wahlberg.
It's all...
John Hamm.
Yes.
Who doesn't like him?
But it's all been amazing, and it's because the ESPY Awards, which I've done for the last 8 years, brings all these amazing athletes and people, and people like Justin Timberlake, and Drake 1 year.
Yeah,
it's so exciting, especially to do that show.
And then you worked on some own shows.
Yes, I did one of Oprah's shows, and I did the first 2 years of Access Hollywood, which was amazing. And I do Lucky Dog. I do a lot of these dog shows.
Oh, fun. Because
I'm such a dog.
Who doesn't love dogs?
Well, I'm such a rescuer and believing in adoption that,
Is that your cause? Is that something
that
you get behind?
That is my cause.
I love that.
I mean, most of my posts are either about what I'm doing or what dogs are doing.
Yeah, yeah.
So...
Did you work with a specific organization with that?
Well, I did this show that is called, Cause for Pause. And it's on Thanksgiving night.
Oh.
And Michael Levitt, who the producer, decided to do a telethon. And so that's when, at one point, Hillary Swank and
I was just gonna say,
Jane Lynch were the hosts.
You've worked with Hillary Swank, who I love.
Oh, my
God. What an amazing actress she is.
Yes. And
is she lovely in person?
Not only that, but to see all these celebrities come on the show to raise awareness about adopting animals.
I love that.
It was, and it still is, probably going to go into its third season. It's so heartwarming, the donations, or to see... three-legged dogs.
And what do they
in.
Do? Help them get adopted?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They do a whole thing. They have celebrities talk about their adoption. They go all over the country. They take shots of dogs that are blind and everything. And people end up adopting all these dogs.
That's great. And does this go on all year?
No, it's the
or just
one
on
telethon.
That one night, the telethon.
Yeah,
so it's a big telethon.
Yeah, on Thanksgiving.
And like... hundreds of dogs get adopted then and there.
And celebrities come in like Betty White and everybody. It's very touching. And I do another show called Lucky Dog with Brandon McMillan, and he is on his second Emmy. It's a show that airs every Saturday on CBS.
Oh, Lucky Dog. I'm
going
to check that out.
Oh, my God. And he just goes and gets dogs that they're going to kill, and he finds families, and then he matches it to the families.
You know, at our upcoming conference on November 12th, the Live, Love, Thrive conference, we're honoring Lisa Vanderpump. I don't know if you know, she has a dog foundation.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yep, Vanderpump Dogs, and they help save dogs from being euthanized. Their focus is on China, and it's a very good cause and wonderful that she gets behind that. It's nice. A lot of celebrities get behind animal causes and
especially animals.
Yeah.
It's so huge.
Yeah, yeah.
So huge.
It's wonderful. I mean, if you're gonna have that kind of status, it's nice to get behind something to make a difference, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I agree.
So that's your love.
It is my love. It's like one dog leaves, another dog comes. Right now I have three dogs.
Aww. What are their names?
Sugar and Buddy, and then I have another little dog called Licorice.
Licorice.
I never say it the right way. It's Licorice.
Yeah.
She's a 15-year-old pug that belongs to my dear friend that I'm taking care of for a while. And
cute.
So.
Yeah, we have a little dog named Angie. She's
cute.
The light of our home.
What kind of dog?
Yeah. Little Maltipoo.
Oh, that's
rescue
what I
dog.
Have. I have a Maltipoo,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, rescue dogs.
Hey.
Yeah. Everybody should have a rescue dog. They're so appreciative and loving and,
it's
awesome.
A different breed. They need, they need your love, and a lot of mine come with issues, and I just feel...
Good thing we don't.
Well, yeah, right. Around 20,000, but okay. That's another show.
That's another show. Have you got another hour?
Not really.
I know you're getting back to the your crime show today. So you have worked with, you know, ABC, NBC, CBS, Bravo, MTV, ESPN. I mean, so many networks. Do you have a favorite network, a favorite show, a favorite celebrity that you've worked with, all three?
You know, I get asked these questions a lot, and I think, you know, I'm a woman of the moment.
Yeah.
Like, I am appreciative of everybody that I've taken care of.
So you really enjoy all your gigs.
There's not anything that I haven't. I love doing Crime Watch Daily because I find that it's interesting. And Chris Hansen, who did To Catch a Predator on NBC years ago, is now the host. And
very important.
You know, I love doing game shows. You know, what's really fascinating about my career is that I come from a high fashion background and I do nothing that has to do with that. I'm really very middle America. But one thing that when I was even working at my parents' store, I love helping people that need to be helped, really.
Right.
It's not like I care about a celebrity-based situation.
Right.
I love helping people feel good about themselves.
Right. It just so happens you're in that niche.
It just,
Yeah. But it sounds like an exciting career. If somebody wanted to get into this career, what would your advice be to them? What's a good path?
Well, I think that, number one, you have to find somebody that's in a stylist area to be an apprentice. So, you know, if you're lucky enough that you meet somebody out, if you're shopping and you see a stylist, and it happens to me all the time, if I think they're really interested, I'll have them come and apprentice with me, and they don't get paid.
That
but
you do that.
Everyone that has done that has really loved it. I took my
and have they gone on to do
oh
it?
Oh my God! My best person that works with me, Robert Cardenas. I took him out of Express when he was 19. He's 27 now, and he's doing a million shows and on his own, and he still works with me.
I love that.
Robert, don't be mad if I said your last name wrong. I'll never get it right. It's Cardenas, I think. So.
But that's really great that you did that. Yeah, you give back and
mentor. You know, it helps them and it helps me.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. No, that 360 karma is always a win-win.
Yes, I love that 360 karma.
Always a win-win.
As your show is.
Yeah.
It's very, your show's amazing, by the way.
Thank you.
I love seeing everybody on it, and I've learned so much about people that I know that I really know nothing about.
Yeah.
And you're a great cause for women and empowerment.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I mean, I think, as I've said before, we can't tell enough women's empowerment stories of women that are doing positive things in the world, because there are so many. I will never run out of guests because there are so many amazing women that contact me every week and that I'm introduced to every week. And I feel really fortunate to be doing this platform because I do meet the most incredible women. And we will continue to tell those stories because they need to be told, and they help other women be inspired. You know, people will see themselves in you. They'll say, you know what, that's my desire, that's my gift. And now, you know, Joanne inspires me to go for it. Because some people think, oh, that's too out of my league. How could I ever become a celebrity stylist? But, you know, you've kind of told them a practical way to approach it. And
I always believe you just have to, if you love something, you have to just do it.
Yep.
And
we paint our own picture.
Exactly.
Life doesn't happen to us. We make it happen, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm so happy that
I
invited myself. Yeah.
Me too. Thanks, Joanne.
No, thank you, Kim.
We'll be right back with Jaylen Moore.
Do you want to have more passion and purpose in your day-to-day? Are you yearning to ignite your power within? Now, more than ever, the world needs women who dream big, inspire others, and are living their greater purpose. There's never been a better time to up your game and make your success happen now. Contact Dani Rukin for a complimentary consultation and find out more about how you can become more effective, energized, and empowered while making a difference in doing what you love. Go to www.danirukin.com. The Live, Love, Thrive radio show is produced by 360karma.com. Are you a 360 Karma woman? If so, spread the word. Be sure to follow us on social media at 360 Karma Women on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Please like us and share us with family and friends. This is the year of the woman, and we are stronger together. The Live, Love, Thrive program is brought to you in part by Honda of Downtown Los Angeles, supporting the equality and empowerment of women. Fans of the Live, Love, Thrive radio show, join us for our Live, Love, Thrive conference in Los Angeles on November 12, 2016. This will be one of the most dynamic and interactive conferences in the country regarding equal pay and the shift of putting more women into positions of influence. Plus, incredible speakers, music, and life-changing tools to help you find your life purpose and create your legacy. Get your tickets now at www.livelovethriveconference.com.
And we are back with Jaylen Moore, my actor friend. Hi, Jaylen. How are you?
Good, good. I'm coming in.
Yes, I love it.
I'm the hugger guy.
You are a hugger, right. And so am I. I am so happy to have you on today. You have exciting things happening in your acting career. Mm-hmm. And then the other reason I had you on is because you are just such an advocate for women. I know you cheer on your screenwriter wife, Britt Logan. And, you know, I think that is awesome.
You know,
for the women's empowerment movement, we need men to get behind it or it won't come to fruition, the equality and moving into positions of influence. So thank you for being a big women's advocate.
Well, thank you.
I appreciate it.
I think we'd be nowhere without our women. I'm a big mama's boy, so there you go. Dad, I love you too, but you know.
You know, and we're, you know, we're going to talk about your career, which, you know, you're always in these like really tough acting roles, and it's so funny because I know you, and I know how, you know, you're just like the kindest, most fun, warm guy, and yet you always play like these like villains and these soldiers, and you know, and it's so funny, and you're right. so good at it. But I mean, that's why they call it acting, right?
Basically, Catherine just told you guys I'm a big teddy bear. Yes. She just outed me. The truth is out.
Don't tell
my agent.
But no, I love that. I like that in a man. I like that a man can be like down to earth, real, authentic, and warm. But also, you know, be a guy. You are, you know, so masculine and such a guy, but you have that warm side to you, and it's really a beautiful mix. I don't really see that in a lot of men, and I think you are a great example of how men should be.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I will credit a lot of that to my father, actually.
My dad's
from Afghanistan, and growing up, he actually would always tell me, he's like, you have to know one thing. Number one, mom.
Yeah.
Then God. Then your sisters. Then me. And I was like, whoa. And so
he really did instill a respect for women.
My father always said that to me, yes.
Yeah. And so that's something we need to do in our culture is have men grow up being taught to have a great respect for women. And that will help make the world a better place for sure.
I agree.
First, though, let's talk about your amazing career. It's like taking off like crazy.
Thank you.
I mean, over the last few years, and I know you've been at this a long time, like, you know, since your teens. We won't say how old you are now, but.
Started when I was 19, and now I'm 20.
still young. All things in perspective. But no, really, you're zooming here. And I know you've been in many movies. I know I mentioned in the opening that you were recently, last year, on the movie, I'm trying to think of the
Hot
name
Pursuit?
Of it. Hot Pursuit, right, with Sofia Vergara and
Reese
Witherspoon.
Reese Witherspoon.
Right, that must have been fun. They have to be fun, those girls.
Yeah, oh, they are.
Yeah, yeah. They're so funny.
Sofia's a hype.
Yeah.
when you're off camera, she's like, oh, good morning, how are you? And you're like, hey.
Yeah.
That energy that she plays on camera is
real.
Is real.
Yeah, she's a good one.
She's wonderful. So is Reese.
Yeah. And then you've guest starred on some really popular shows like Homeland and NCIS and CSI. In fact, we have a clip of you on NCIS LA. Let's just take a quick look at that.
Right on.
How are you?
Warren Samir, NSA.
It's with the cuffs. I woke up out of here cuffed to a metal pipe. It took a while, but I managed to get free.
You have any idea who they are?
I heard a little chatter before I passed out. Pretty sure it's ISIS.
Omar Mubarak?
And Joseph Abak.
What do your people know about Abak?
We've been trying to track him for the past few months. As far as we can tell, he's an associate of the cell that Mubarak leads here in L.A. There's rumors he's a traitor, feeding intel to the feds.
Rumors?
Unsubstantiated. We don't believe it. We think Mubarak has something big planned.
See what I mean? You're always involved in something sinister.
Cliffhanger. Am I a good guy? Am I not? You'll have to see a replay of that episode.
Yeah, I have to tell. I have to see.
Yes.
But I want to, before we talk about the groundbreaking role that you're playing in this new series, I just want to ask you, what was it like being on CSI and NCIS? And by the way, in my upcoming webisode series, we have Ann Donahue, who is the creator and executive producer of CSI, wonderful woman.
Power woman, right there.
And created one of the most successful franchises in history, which is the CSI series. So what was it like to be on that and all these different shows, Homeland and...
Well, CSI Miami and CSI New York was when earlier in my career, and it was such an honor to be on that show.
I mean,
getting on set and just seeing the actors, and then on New York specifically, working with Gary Sinise and Anthony Hemingway, who is a huge director. I mean, his career is skyrocketing right now. And same with Miami. But NCIS, as you were saying, that was really fun for me because I always was a fan of LL Cool J and Chris O'Donnell. And so when I booked that, it was actually exciting because my father was like, tell JJ Cool. I said, hello. I'm like, you mean LL Cool J? JJ Cool. Perfect.
Right.
And I told him that, and he goes, dude, your dad's awesome. Let's take a picture for him. I was like, all right.
Yeah. But, and you were just in that scene with him, LL Cool J.
Him and Chris O'Donnell, So, but working on all those shows was a great, what can I say?
Kind of a stepping stone, right?
Great stepping stone, and it taught me a lot. You know, like, as an actor, you can always do so much in your acting classes and your workshops. Mm-hmm. But when you work on a set with seasoned actors like that.
Yeah, you learn from them.
You just soak it in, and you play. You know, you play. And every role that I've booked from here up to my career and I'm sure beyond, I'm just always grateful for and soaking in the fun on set. You know?
Yeah. And speaking of that, I love your dad. And I know when you get a movie script, he always asks you one question, right?
Which one in particular?
How many lines?
Oh, yeah. That's it's an Afghani thing. My mother's so wonderful. She's like, Fazl, don't worry about it. But that's the number. Yes.
Yeah.
Even the series that I'm in now, he's like, oh, it's great. When are you coming out? And so how many lines in episode one? Episode two, good. More lines? I don't know what it is.
How many lines?
It's my relatives,
but every
too.
Time you book it, how many lines?
They all say this. I'm like, well, what kind of lines are you talking about? Dad, I'm healthy. Yes, we're talking about movies. Correct. Yes. Yeah, he cracks me up with that question. Right. So it's humor. I humor it now. My dad, a lot of lines.
I know. He's an awesome guy. Your mom and dad. What was I going to say? So I was going to ask you about this new series, which is a Harvey Weinstein produced series. Now, that right there says quality.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is Harvey Weinstein's first baby, his television venture, I should say, when it comes to first baby. And
it's
History
called
Channel,
Six.
I've created a show called Six,
yeah.
Based on SEAL Team Six. Mm-hmm. And they were the SEAL team that caught bin Laden and took him out. And they weren't really known until that happened. And,
oh, so it's and, about in the SEALs that caught bin Laden. Oh, okay.
Yes, essentially. Not specific ones,
right.
Obviously, to protect those men who have served bravely. But this show is loosely based on, because in the SEALs, you have different teams.
Mm-hmm.
And so SEAL Team 6 is what is known as the elite top. Them and Delta, it's arguable. But I love both sides, for any Delta guys that are listening.
Yeah.
SEAL Team 6 is just known as the elite force that the
It's a women's empowerment show. I doubt any of those Delta guys are listening.
And, well, their wives may be.
But you never know.
You never know. You never know. I just want to cover my own butt. They answer to the president. And so they're sent all the secret and top missions.
Right.
And so this show basically shows their lifestyle of training, what it takes to when you go overseas. And there's a couple of storylines within there that have to do with Boko Haram and Taliban. But more importantly, what the show really does capture and show to the audience, you'll see, is the home life. When you come home and these strong, strong women, these wives who have to, it's a roller coaster for them. You know what they have to go through when their husbands are over at sea and they don't know what they're doing.
Right.
They can't, it's 'cause it's all top secret. You can't talk about it when you're a part of six.
Right.
And so to see how strong these women have to be. Right. To not only take care of the kids
and
the family,
but support. Oh, so the show really does show that part of it.
Huge. Hugely.
Oh, I love that.
And Nadine Velasquez and Brienne Davis play the wives, and they're amazing actresses. They brought it.
Oh, I love that. Yeah, I can't wait to see it. And it comes out on the History Channel in January 2017.
Yeah. Yes. So we'll have our official date in November, they'll announce. Mm-hmm. In early January.
And it's called Six.
Six.
S-I-X.
History Channel. Okay. Correct.
And so in order to prepare for this, a lot of people don't know what actors go through in order to play a role. I mean, you had to go through some serious SEAL training, right? I mean, didn't some people drop out and say, I can't do it?
Oh, man. Yeah. Well, luckily, our core cast, six guys, go figure, show's called Six. we had to go through a vigorous boot camp with the Navy SEALs.
Yeah.
And we were sent down to San Diego or Encinitas, and it was...
Wait, before you went there, did you have any idea what you were getting into? Like,
no, I did not. to be honest, I didn't. I'm an athlete myself, and I always stay on top of my training because I crave it and I love it. But I was not prepared for this.
Yeah.
I just knew you booked it.
I know you have a wicked six-pack here. And just saying.
That's the next time I come for the interview. And
that's
they
not
said,
that kind of show.
You are correct. Thank you, Catherine. In 3 days, you're getting picked up, and you will be in a boot camp. And I was like, what? And at first I thought, ah. How hard can it be?
Right, because you're a trainer, and
And my lovely wife, my champion, my fan, she's like, you'll be fine, honey, don't worry. I'm like, great, cool. First day I get there, I texted her. I said, no phones for the next week, and I'm already dead. They gave us a taste of what their version is of BUDS, you know, BUDS. If you look at BUDS on YouTube, it's a six-month course. We got a smidgen of that, and that alone was hard enough.
And do we know what BUD stands for?
Basic underwater
or is that
demolition.
Top secret?
No, basic underwater demolition training for the SEALs.
Oh, wow.
Yes. So
it was intense.
Yes, it was. A lot of ocean, a lot of high current pulling us in, 2-3 in the morning, heavy sandbags.
Oh my God. 2-3 in the morning you had to do it?
Eating gourmet MREs, and they are not gourmet.
Yeah.
A lot of power bars, 20 mile hikes, 40 pound rucksacks, et cetera, et cetera.
Oh my gosh.
So,
wow.
It was tough, but
and
I'm
happy
they did it.
And this was so that you understood what they went through, or was it to get you in even more tip top shape? I don't know how you could be in any better shape than you are.
If they wanted to get us in shape, they could have just hired us a trainer. No, it was to give us a better understanding
of what they go through.
A little sprinkle, a taste.
Yeah.
Of what it takes, the mentality to be a Navy SEAL, especially a part of DevGRU, which is a short term for development group, which they refer to as SEAL Team 6.
So this is if Navy SEALs isn't intense enough, this 6 is like the creme de la creme.
Yes.
Like the most intense. Wow. Yeah. What a great experience.
Yeah, and it brought us together, but it brought a camaraderie with the ensemble cast that when Mr. Weinstein was there at the table read and our writers and creators, when they saw us after the boot camp, they couldn't believe the energy that we all walked in with, the camaraderie. It looked like we were brothers for 20 years. And at that point, we'd only known each other for maybe 2 weeks.
Wow. But that experience was
to hell and back.
Bonding.
We
all to hell and back.
Point. Yeah.
And so, and who else is on this series? Anybody that we would know?
Barry Sloan. Uh-huh. He is he's the lead of our show. He was in Revenge, Longmire. He played Aiden on Revenge, ladies, for all those who love the British guy, Aiden. He's a great guy. Kyle Schmid from Canada, very well-known actor, was on Degrassi back in the day. Edwin Hodge, who's worked a lot. Juan Pablo Raba from Narcos and some other shows.
A lot of people love that new show, Narcos.
Yours truly. Here with the lovely Catherine, Brienne Davis, Nadine Velasquez, and so the cast goes on and on. Just Dominic Adams, who's a great actor from a British actor, who's our antagonist.
Oh, sounds like a great ensemble.
Yeah.
And so one thing I want to talk about that the audience will be really fascinated with, I think, is that you are the first person ever to be cast as an Afghan American soldier in a show.
Yes.
I mean, that's big, yes, especially is, with what's just happened in the whole political debacle about, you know, the couple that got up and talked about losing their African-American son to the war and how that all got knocked out of whack.
It was a blessing how this came along. And Donnie Boaz, he plays our Texas guy. I can't forget about that.
Don't forget Texas. Don't
Donnie
forget your buds.
Kill me if I forgot. So it was a blessing how this came along. I got to play a role that speaks so close to my heart. You know,
Because your family is from Afghanistan.
Yes, and yeah. I actually have a relative.
Your dad is from there.
Yeah, who's in the Special Forces, and he is the first Afghan American Muslim soldier. So for me to...
In this role that you play.
So the role, that's actually the real deal. For me to play a role that is parallel to my cousin's life was an honor.
Oh,
you know,
right.
I will be the first on television.
Wait, so your cousin was the first?
Yeah, he's the first Green Beret in Special Forces who is Afghan, born in Afghanistan, who is Muslim. I call him the Afghan Jason Bourne.
Yeah.
Let's just say he does a lot of that world.
Oh,
he's in that world.
And you told me you brought him on the set.
I did.
Yeah. How interesting.
So we got to check it out, and he's like, "You guys are doing a good job. You look real." And I said, "Thank you." You know, it's you we take our hats off to, all the vets.
Now, how do you, you know, since you're playing this part, how do you feel about what just unfolded on the political front about, you know, talking about, I mean, since your family is part Afghanistan Muslim, how do you feel about what's being said about, I mean, how could you feel, you know, but, and I mean, it's kind of a silly question, but about this deportation thing and scrutinizing people and it feels like racial profiling to me, but.
At first, to be honest, I laugh at it.
Yeah.
I always try to laugh at something that is just so preposterous, in my opinion. It saddens me.
I mean, I'm just saying this knowing what good people you are, and you're one of the only Afghan families that I know, but just what a wonderful family. And for someone to be putting this blanket statement out there, it just seems, like you said, so preposterous.
It saddens me because what I just feel sad about is people who do follow or believe in what he says. He as in Trump, I'll say the name. What they're not realizing is that there are just so many wonderful, beautiful, kind people in the world, but in here in the United States who are Muslim, who are my relatives or who aren't my relatives, but who just love this country, would die for this country, who are serving in our armed forces, men
Absolutely.
And women.
Yes.
And so it just saddens me that, you know, he would blanket this, he or any other person would,
right,
and just say, yeah, send them all back, this or that, when you don't really realize that you're kind of doing that to yourself, if that makes sense. Because in my opinion, we're
or
all
one. Or even
to
profile people, even to say, well, no, we'll keep the good ones. Well, who determines what that means? And and then to even take any group of people and have to put them through some sort of, filter. I mean, that's just,
Yeah, no, and that's why, again, I feel honored to have this role, because it's a...
Yeah, that's what I think this role is important.
It allows me to show a character that... I also was heavily involved with the writers and sharing my own experiences and how I grew up. Mm-hmm. You know, a character that just is full of love, American
integrity.
Pride.
Integrity. Yes.
Doesn't see color or religion or creed and fights for our country.
Right.
So.
Right. And by the way, I never even think about the fact that your family's from Afghanistan or that Muslim or whatever. I want to know, when I went to your wedding, you did both types of ceremonies and whatnot, and that was really cool. It was wonderful to see two different cultures coming together. But like you said, when I look at the person, I don't see any of those things. I just see, oh, I love that person.
Yes.
And this is the way the world should be. We should be looking at people as human beings, not as colors, not as religions, not as men or women, but as people. And how can we come together and have a more peaceful world, a more loving world, and respect each other as people?
Put more women in power. That's how you'll get there.
I really mean that.
I do mean that. Yes.
So, I know also too. You teach a class that helps women learn defense skills to empower themselves to be not afraid to be out in the world and to know that they can take care of themselves. Tell me just a little bit about that as we're wrapping up.
So my wife and I, Britt, I made her part of that because she's awesome. And, you know, she's a little badass. sorry if I said that. I'm not supposed to. But so there's a course that we both teach together called the All-in-One Empowerment Course. And I say all-in-one because it's not just your typical self-defense course. Mm-hmm. I cover a lot, and I try to do it within 4 weeks, 2 hours at a time with women. I first interview them, and I talk about what are your fears? Is there any confidence that you lack within yourself? And then I customize it for my group. And from there, I go through your health lifestyle. Whether you don't have to be super ripped to be strong and confident, mm-hmm. you know. And the point of that, me saying that, is that I feel that women of all shapes, sizes, doesn't matter. If you walk with that confidence and that light that you have and you shine, it can ward off a predator or attacker.
Right.
And a lot of women don't realize that. Some think that they just need to know how to kick butt or to have a weapon, which can always help.
Right.
But it all starts with who you are, your spirit, your light. If the brighter it shines, the more confidence they have, which I go over and instill through different ways in my courses. That is a set foundation.
And what's the name of your course?
All-in-One Empowerment Course.
And can they find that where? Online?
I don't have a website up because I do it when I'm in between shows on a hiatus like I am now. But
right.
You can email me at jaylen@jaylenmoore.com. J-A-Y-L-E-N. @jaylenmoore.com. And
that's
that can give
great.
You more information and talk to you about it.
That's
I kind of keep it a little
that.
Underground and do it on referral
right.
instead of just putting it out there on blast.
Right, right. But it's good that I love the way, you know, I always like to showcase people that are giving back. And mm-hmm. I know you give back in so many ways, and that's one of them, is teaching this course to women to empower them physically, mentally, spiritually. And just as we are wrapping up, I just want to mention that your wife, which is Britt Logan, who mm-hmm. is a very talented up-and-coming screenwriter. You're both trailblazing here in Hollywood. You're like power couple, awesome people. And I know that you help each other. And I know that you've taken some course that has brought you guys closer and made you such a strong unit as parents now. You have a beautiful daughter now.
20 months old, little yeah. Cabbage Patch. Yes, she
yeah.
is my world.
And what is that course that you guys took?
So we took a course called Genesis. It is it's ran by Dr. Nikki Monti here in Los Angeles. And think of Genesis as like a year of therapy in like 5 days.
Yeah.
I'm just one of those few that is open to it. Well, after a kick from my wife saying, you need, we all have our patterns and things that evolve
yeah,
within
I think
us
every couple has
that
to
cause
work
frustrations in this. And so
yeah.
I think why we have such a strong and wonderful marriage and we're such a support team for each other is because we've done this course together and we've done therapy together. And
done the
so,
work.
And we've done the work that you don't want to do.
Right.
You know,
but then when you do it,
yeah.
it's so worth it because
yes,
you guys have the most rocking marriage. I mean,
thank you. Thank
yeah.
you. And it's not always rainbows and unicorns, as I say. You know, there's
yeah.
ups and downs, but what the course has taught us.
Did you have a fight
us,
this morning? No, I'm just
we
kidding.
Did. We did out in the lobby. No. We, what it does is it teaches you to identify each other's patterns.
Yeah.
So that if something might be bothering me, Brittany won't take it
personally.
She'll know that that's something within from
so
mother,
then you have
father,
empathy
child.
For each other instead.
Yeah, and she'll understand where it comes yeah. from. And when I can calm down and I can speak to her and tell her, like, you know what, that came from this and it triggered this. And,
yeah.
You know, it's
understanding
wonderful.
Understanding each other.
You understand
yeah.
your own human nature.
Yeah.
And the course, I say, saved my life. It completely changed me and us together as a couple. And we're just growing together in this wonderful power. We just had our anniversary. 9 years together, 4 years married, going strong.
Yeah.
And hopefully,
that's awesome.
You know, 100 more years.
Well, you guys are a real inspiring couple here in Hollywood as rising
Thank
stars,
you.
As actor and screenwriter, and just an amazing, beautiful being. And we need more beautiful, authentic people here in Hollywood. And I'm glad that you're perpetuating that. And I wish you all the luck with your new Series 6 that we'll be watching for in January
Thank
on
you.
The History Channel. It's
Thank you,
groundbreaking
Catherine.
And awesome, just like you.
Oh.
Thank
Appreciate
you for
it.
Being here.
Not as awesome as you, though.
Oh,
she's the best.
I love that. Thank you. All
Thank
right.
You.
Well, we will see you next week. Hugs and happiness.
Do you want to have more passion and purpose in your day-to-day? Are you yearning to ignite your power within? Now, more than ever, the world needs women who dream big, inspire others, and are living their greater purpose. There's never been a better time to up your game and make your success happen now. Contact Dani Rukin for a complimentary consultation and find out more about how you can become more effective, energized, and empowered while making a difference in doing what you love. Go to www.dannyrukin.com. The Live, Love, Thrive program is brought to you in part by Honda of Downtown Los Angeles, supporting the equality and empowerment of women. The Live, Love, Thrive radio show is produced by 360karma.com. Are you a 360 Karma woman? If so, spread the word. Be sure to follow us on social media at 360 Karma Women on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Please like us and share us with family and friends. This is the year of the woman, and we are stronger together. Fans of the Live, Love, Thrive radio show, join us for our Live, Love, Thrive conference in Los Angeles on November 12th, 2016. This will be one of the most dynamic and interactive conferences in the country regarding equal pay and the shift of putting more women into positions of influence. Plus, incredible speakers, music, and life-changing tools to help you find your life purpose and create your legacy. Get your tickets now at www.livelovethriveconference.com.